About 80 years ago, physicists around the world suddenly began discovering a large amount of different kinds of small particles. Until then, most scientists were aware of at least three kinds of particles: electrons, protons, and neutrons, or the particles which make up matter, along with photons, mysterious massless particles which are believed to transport light. Many of these new particles had some funny properties. They were given names such as strange and charm. A few of them could pass through millions of miles of metal without losing any speed, and at least one was so odd that scientists only managed to create it in 2013. Today, we call all these particles along with a bunch of forces as the standard model, which is based on an interesting premise called Yang-Mills theory. And clarifying some of it can give you $1 million. The Yang-Mills and mass gap problem is another one of the elusive Millennium Prize problems, a set of seven problems given in the year 2000 by the Clay Mathematical Institute, and solving one of them can earn you $1 million. For a long time, the holy grail of physics has been to construct something called a grand unified theory, or GUT. The GUT is supposed to answer some of our most burning questions, like the truth about our four fundamental forces. These are some of the forces which control the working of the universe and are generally called 1. Gravity, which pulls together large planets and stars and galaxies. 2. Electromagnetism, like sticking a balloon on the wall or what makes your batteries, TV and electric lighting work. 3. The strong nuclear force, which attaches protons and neutrons together in the atom. And 4. The weak nuclear force, which is mostly involved in radioactivity. These forces act differently, but physicists believe at the moment of the Big Bang, they were all part of one grand unified force. In 1979, three scientists won the Nobel Prize for showing that when the temperature of the universe is about 10 to the power 15 degrees, then the electromagnetic and the weak forces combine together to form a unified electroweak force. The GUT is supposed to be a similar combination of all the four individual theories of each of the forces. Since the 1930s, physicists have been confident that each of these forces will be described using quantum theory, which is actually a group of different intertwined theories which describe how very small particles behave. How is this related to the forces? Simple. Each force requires a transmission particle which carries information from one object to another. For the electromagnetic force, the particles are photons. For the strong and weak force, gluons and W and Z bosons respectively. We've theorized that gravity also runs through a particle called the graviton, but it's never been seen or even measured, so gravity is still a toss-up. The mathematical framework on which quantum mechanics is based is not elementary. There is no concept of what we would call velocity or the trajectory of a particle. Instead, particles are indistinguishable from waves. You can imagine a particle in quantum mechanics as simply a region of space with some properties. Now, in your school, you probably learned of the concept of a plane, a region on which it's possible to draw figures like lines, triangles, circles, or other interesting types of curves. Similarly, you can make three-dimensional space, which differs from a plane by having an extra dimension, height. Usually, the three dimensions of length, breadth, and height comprise space. In quantum theory, on the other hand, space exists, but it's considerably less arbitrarily defined. Here, we use a precise framework generated in the first decade of the 20th century called a Hilbert space. A Hilbert space can be generalized as an n-dimensional space in which you can perform a special kind of multiplication, something known as an inner product. We can use these terms to define things like position or velocity simply as an operation carried out in the Hilbert space. And things such as trajectory don't make sense, because the path the particle takes is irrelevant. For all we know, it takes every possible path to reach a certain location. Now, another integral concept in physics is the idea of a field, which is basically the region in which stuff plays out. For example, if we have a particle with a positive charge, it pulls other particles that have a negative charge towards it. We know that the pull decreases the further away the negatively charged particle is, so we can say that the area for which the pull is some substantial quantity is called the field. This makes it clear that fields interact with other particles, and thus it makes sense that our quantum theory has to involve fields as well. But when we try to incorporate fields into a Hilbert space, we find something crazy. For all practical purposes, in our Hilbert space, fields and particles have no difference. This may seem unexpected, but this is because particles in fact are none other than excitations in the field. Sometimes in a field, there are momentary bursts of energy, which we interpret as states of the quantum field. These states are what we know as particles, though the exact technicalities vary from field to field. Theories related to these fields are known as quantum field theories, or QFTs, like quantum electrodynamics or quantum chromodynamics. These specific kind of theories, including all the QFTs, are known as gauge theories. Gauge theory says that more often than not, if you create certain changes in the parameters of the particles, the overall physics remains the same, creating a kind of symmetry. For example, let's say we have a wave with some equation like this. If we shift the wave a little bit to the right, then the equation changes subtly. We get this extra variable called the phase. The phase depends on our starting point and compensates for the change. Now here's an interesting observation. If we also shift the entire universe a little to the right, then our phase vanishes. The underlying physics remains the same. This creates a symmetry. If we shift our wave and the universe together, then there's no change. In gauge theory, this kind of symmetry is called gauge invariance. The first gauge theory to be made was quantum electrodynamics, or QED. In the 1860s, James Clerk Maxwell and Michael Faraday created one of the most successful theories of all time, the classical theory of electromagnetism, which combined electricity, the magnetic force, and light to show that all these three are nothing but the proponents of the same thing, the electromagnetic force. It showed, using four equations, that the electric and magnetic forces transfer in the form of waves, which oscillate perpendicular to each other at the speed of light, called an electromagnetic wave. About 70 years later, scientists tried to create a quantum version of this, quantum electrodynamics, which is probably the most successful theory of all time. There's no discrepancy between QED and any experiment which has ever been done. After looking at the immeasurable success of QED, physicists were puzzled by the question, do QFTs exist for all the four fundamental forces? This is where the problem began. Scientists realized that any gauge theory that actually works in physics has to also satisfy a condition, which it also has to be a Yang-Mills theory. Yang-Mills theory attempts to describe the properties of particles in the form of non-abelian Lie groups. For this, we need to look at groupings. A group is essentially a way of defining symmetries. For example, if we have a circle, we can look at the group of rotations on a circle. Since any degree of rotation maintains the symmetry, this is called a continuous group and consists of an infinite number of elements. Similarly, even addition to the real numbers is a group, because A plus B is equal to B plus A. Thus, a group is defined by some sort of symmetry. There are some special kinds of groups called Lie groups, which have interesting properties that help in our discussion of fields. A Yang-Mills theory uses these symmetries and performs some special operations on them to define fields and particles. Now, the major problem at this time was that the strong and weak forces were carried around by particles which had mass. QED was a theory in which the carrying particles were massless photons. On the other hand, the transmission particles of the nuclear interactions acted only for a very short distance, and some of them had mass. But after many years of trying, scientists finally managed to come up with quantum chromodynamics, or QCD, the theory of the strong interaction. For QCD to describe the strong force, it must satisfy three parameters. First, the theory needs to account for a mass gap. That is, there must be some minimum energy that every excitation in the vacuum must have. Since the energy of the empty vacuum is zero, there has to be some finite energy that each particle needs to have to exist. Below that energy, these excitations cannot take place and particles can't exist. This parameter helps describe why the strong force acts only over very small distances. Secondly, it must have quark confinement, or it must explain why you can never see individual quarks in nature, and always lumped up to form protons and other combination particles. Thirdly, it must have something called chiral symmetry breaking, which is essentially a specific kind of symmetry. All of these parameters tend to be true via experimentation and by computer simulations, and it's thus commonly accepted in the physics community that QCD is an analytically correct representation of the strong force. But there's no mathematical representation of this specific fact, and thus the theory is not mathematically consistent as of now. The million-dollar problem has to consist such a Yang-Mills theory in a four-dimensional Hilbert space, which has a mass gap, and prove that this kind of Yang-Mills theory exists for every group defined on a gauge theory. The consequence would be that we have to create a QFT for every gauge theory that we have, in essence quantifying as many parameters as we feel. Thus, it could possibly be a step towards a completely consistent grand unified theory, but let's be serious here. The truth is that physicists don't really care much for a rigorous proof of the mass gap. Physicists are actually pretty sure that the mass gap exists, and the confirmation would just be a nice finish to QCD. So what's the real reason for this being a Millennium Prize problem? It's because mathematicians are really touchy about being unable to prove something. There's no profound reason for the problem being here. It's just that mathematicians want to tie a little bow on QCD before shipping off. Now that we know what the problem is, write down in the comments below what you think about the Yang-Mills problem, and feel free to give your feedback below. As always, Thanks to these people for commenting, and don't forget to leave a like and subscribe. Thanks for watching!